Om Namo Bhagavate Vasudevaya. Om Namo Bhagavate Vasudevaya. Om Namo Bhagavate Vasudevaya. Sri Suka Uvacha.
Sri Suka Uvacha.
Sevam Bhagavata Rajan.
Sevam Bhagavata Rajan.
Vaidarbhi Parishantita.
Vaidarbhi Parishantita.
Gyatvatat Parihashoktim. Priyathyaga bayam jahau.
Priyathyaga bayam jahau.
Sri Suka Uvacha.
Sri Suka Uvacha.
Saivam Bhagavata Rajan.
Saivam Bhagavata Rajan.
Vaidarbhi Parishantvita.
Vaidarbhi Parishantvita.
Yatvatat Parihasoktim. Priyathyaga bayam jahau.
Priyathyaga bayam jahau.
Sri Suka Uvacha.
Sri Suka Uvacha.
Saivam Bhagavata Rajan.
Saivam Bhagavata Rajan.
Vaidarbhi Parishantvita.
Vaidarbhi Parishantvita.
Yatvatat Parihasoktim. Priyathyaga bayam jahau.
Priyathyaga bayam jahau.
Sri Suka Uvacha.
Saivam Bhagavata Rajan.
Vaidarbhi Parishantita.
Priya Tyaga Bhayam Jaho.
Shuka Uvacha. Shukadev Goswami said,
Sa, she,
evam,
thus,
Bhagavata, by the Supreme Personality of Godhead, Rajan, O King, Vaidarbhi, Queen Rukmini, Parishantvita, fully pacified, Gyatva,
understanding,
Tat, his, Parihas,
spoken in jest,
Uktim,
words,
Priya,
by her beloved,
Tyag,
of rejection,
Bhayam,
her fear,
Jahao,
gave up.
Shukadev Goswami said, O King, Queen Vaidarbhi was fully pacified by the Supreme Personality of Godhead and understood that his words had been spoken in jest. Thus she gave up her fear that her beloved would reject her. Smiling bashfully as she cast charming, affectionate glances upon the face of the Lord, the best of males, Rukmini spoke the following, O descendant of Bharat. Sri Rukmini said, Actually, what you have said is true, O lotus-eyed one. I am indeed unsuitable for the almighty personality of Godhead. What comparison is there between the Supreme Lord, who is master of the three primal deities, who delights in his own glory, and myself, a woman of mundane qualities, whose feet are grasped by fools? Purport. Srila Sridhar Swami lists the faults Lord Krishna had described in himself, that he claimed disqualified him from being Rukmini's husband. These include incompatibility, fearfulness, taking shelter in the ocean, quarreling with the powerful, abandoning his kingdom, uncertainty as to his identity, acting against ordinary standards of behavior, having no good qualities, being praised falsely by beggars, aloofness, and a lack of desire for family life. The Lord claimed that Rukmini had failed to recognize these bad qualities in him. Now she begins to respond to all the Lord's statements. First, she responds to Sri Krishna's statement in text 11 of this chapter. Kasma no vavrise saman. Why did you select us, who are not equal to you? Here, Srimati Rukmini Devi says that she and Lord Krishna are certainly not equal, for no one can be equal to the Supreme Lord. Srila Vishwanath Chakravarti further points out that in her extreme humility, Rukmini is identifying herself with the Lord's external energy, which in fact is her expansion, Rukmini being the goddess of fortune. Om Akyan Timidandasya Gyananjana Chalakaya
Chakshurum Vidham Jena Tasmai Sri Gurave Namaha Sri Chaitanya Manobhishtam Sthapitam Yena Bhutale Swayam Rupa Kadamayam Tadati Swapadantikam Vandeham Sri Guru Sri Yudhapada Kamalam Sri Gurun Vaishnavamscha Sri Rupam Sagrajatam Sahagana Raghunatham Vitam Tam Sajivam Sadvaitam Savadutam Parijana Sahitam Krishna Chaitanya Devam Sri Radha Krishna Padam Sahagana Lalita Sri Vishakam Vitamscha He Krishna Karuna Sindhu Dinabandhu Jagatpate Gopesha Gopika Kanta Radha Kanta Namostate Tapta Kanchana Gurangi Radhe Vrindavani Sute Devi Pranamami Hari Priye Vansha Kalpatarubhyascha Kripa Sindubhya Evacha Patitanam Bhavanibhyo Vaishnavibhyo Namo Namaha Sri Krishna Chaitanya Prabhu Nityananda Sri Advaita Gadadhar Shivasadi Gaura Bhakta Brinda Hare Krishna 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 Hare 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 Rama Hare Rama Rama Rama
Hare Krishna. Thank you for being here today. We are speaking from Srimad Bhagavatam, Canto 10, Chapter 60, entitled Krishna Teases Rukmini, Text 32 through 34. At the beginning of this chapter, Srila Vishwanath Chakravarti Thakur gives a beautiful analogy. He tells that this chapter Rukmini's qualities, her loving qualities, are compared to camphor. And Krishna's apparently very harsh words are like a grinding stone. And when you grind camphor, the fragrance of the camphor manifests like never before. So in the same way, in Krishna's relationships with his dear devotees, in many ways, sometimes with his smile, sometimes through the sweet sound of his flute, sometimes through harsh words, neglectful words, in whatever way he approaches his devotees, it's to bring out the loving qualities of his devotees. Because ultimately, in the relationships between Krishna and his associates, there is only one subject matter, and that is rasa, exchange of intimate, pure love. And as Krishna sometimes in inconceivable ways, Ultimately, everything Krishna does is inconceivable. The more we sincerely try to conceive of it, we understand it's inconceivable. If we don't really go deep into trying to conceive, it may appear conceivable. Because Krishna has achintya shakti. Whatever he does, whatever he says, everything about him, and everything about his relationship with his devotees is inconceivable. What does inconceivable mean? It means our intelligence, our mind, our logical prowess, our mastery over Sanskrit, or the different systems of philosophy, can never equip us to truly comprehend Krishna's infinite loving nature in every aspect of his personality. And because it's so inconceivable, some people just take another way, that God must be impersonal. Ultimately, he must be impersonal. Because we see when he descends into this world as a person, yada yada hi dharmasya glanir bhavati bharata, he does such incredible things. In order to try to conceive what is God, it's easier to conceive the inconceivable as impersonal, which means you don't really have to conceive it at all, because it's just ever existing and it always is. Although Brahman is inconceivable, we cannot actually conceive of a reality that is beyond space, beyond time, that is infinitely extending. And it's hard to even say infinitely extending everywhere, because he's infinitely beyond everywhere and beyond that. Because within this material world, because we have bodies, and even subtle bodies, we see things according to quantity and according to space and according to time. But Krishna's form, Krishna's personality, Krishna's words, Krishna's activities, they are all beyond time. They are all beyond any geographical limitations. The analogy of Ananta Shesha, who's with many heads. He's an expansion of Balaram, Krishna's intimate associate. So he knows what Krishna does and he knows what Krishna says. But through the span of an entire universal creation, with all of his mouths, he cannot sufficiently explain what Krishna or Lord Chaitanya does in one moment. That's quite inconceivable. When we read Srimad Bhagavatam, because we are so deceived by our misconception that we can conceive, we read a story and then we hear it again. I already know that one. I've heard that so many times. Let's get to something else. But we find when Lord Chaitanya was with Gadadhar Pandit at Tota Gopinath, they would read and discuss the same story that we do. Dhruva, Prahlad Maharaj. How many times have we heard that story? And they're reading the same pages of Srimad Bhagavatam that we read. But they just are tasting so much nectar. It's going deeper and deeper and deeper. It's without limit. They recite it and hear it and go deep into ecstasy in the experience 100 times. Then they go on to the next story. And then they keep coming back to it 100 times, 100 times. Because they're actually tasting the inconceivable experience. It's actually inconceivable, the idea that just by hearing or reading Krishna's pastimes, or the pastimes of his intimate pure devotees, we are actually there. It's happening at this moment. That's inconceivable. Because from the framework of the way the universe is conceived, when Krishna was speaking to Rukmini, as in this chapter, this took place over 5,000 years ago. But through sound, which is non-different than Krishna, every time we hear it with an open and receptive heart, with faith, the pastime is actually happening right now. That's inconceivable. When you talk about Indian history or American history of various politicians or reformers, what they did even 50 years ago, it's not happening now. Even what happened 20 years ago, it's not happening. What happened yesterday, it's not happening now. It happened then, and we're just remembering it. But on the spiritual level, whenever devotees chant and hear with faith and enthusiasm and a pure heart, it's happening. Krishna's there. Inconceivable how the Paramatma, how the one supreme person, Bhagavan, first of all, he can expand himself to be the one supreme person, Bhagavan, in limitless Vaikuntha planets forever, to have pastimes with his intimate devotees forever. And surrounding it at all is his Brahman effulgence, which is ever-existing light. It's all-pervading. And that's that Bhagavan personally appears within the heart of every living being. Not like some reflection. Each one, individual, independent, personally taking care of you. And it's all the same Paramatma. You have your own special Paramatma, whether you want or not. That same Paramatma is with you through every birth and every death. And he's personally your Paramatma. And you're personally his, ultimately. And yet, the same Paramatma is personally within the insect, and the snake, and the tree, and the plant, the vegetable, within the atomic particles, in and between every atom, every bird. When we see a cat catch a bird and eat it, there's a special Paramatma in the cat's heart watching, and a special Paramatma in the bird's heart watching. Every living being, even the bacteria, there's a little Paramatma right there watching. And we think about the big population of Mumbai, what is it, 15 million people. And the population of India, 1.2 billion, 15 million people here and 1.2 billion people in India, and so many billions of people on the planet Earth. But as far as living entities within this little planet Earth, Krishna knows exactly how many living entities are here. And he is personally the Paramatma, the personal Paramatma for every living entity. And it's absolutely impossible to ever make, for us to make a census of how many living entities there are. There's probably more living entities living in your body than in the city of Mumbai. And yet Krishna's with everyone. Inconceivable. And the more we try to conceive it, the more we realize we cannot conceive it. We can only conceive that it is inconceivable. And that is why in the bhakti path we understand that the only way to truly understand Krishna with a substantial realization, because on the spiritual level, understanding is not theoretical. Theoretical knowledge is a way, it's a necessary way by which we can approach real understanding. But true understanding of the inconceivable is only possible by the grace of the inconceivable. When Krishna reveals himself to us, then we could understand. And what is the understanding? Sri Chaitanya Mahaprabhu is Krishna himself in the mood of Sri Radha. Now this is inconceivable because Krishna is saying, Radha knows me better than I know me. I want to understand her the way she, I want to understand myself the way she understands me. I want to understand the nature of my love the way she tastes the nature of my love. I want to understand the qualities that make her so ecstatic that I can't even understand. I want to taste that too. So he appears as Lord Chaitanya. Radha Krishna Pranaya Vikratirtha Dini Shakti Radha. The one Supreme Absolute Truth is eternally in two forms, as the Shaktiman and the Shakti, Radha Krishna. And now they have come together as one. Radha Bhavaduti Suvalitam Nomi Krishna Swarupam. And Lord Chaitanya is telling Rupa Goswami that to understand what love for Krishna is, what this tattvas of Krishna and the jiva and bhakti and rasa, these loving exchanges between Krishna, the infinite absolute truth, and his beloved devotees. They are like a limitless ocean. An ocean that has no bottom, and an ocean that has no shores on any of the eight directions. It's limitless. An ocean that extends infinitely forever in every direction without end and has no bottom. And Lord Chaitanya himself, who's Krishna, who's playing role of devotee, he is saying that I am going to try to explain one part of one drop from that ocean. Because that's all any of us can hope to explain. One part of one drop from a limitless ocean of Krishna's love for us, and a devotee's love for Krishna, and the dynamic eternal pastimes that are enacted through that love. And then Lord Chaitanya says something that's even more inconceivable if we really open our hearts to hear. He says that particle of one drop is enough to completely inundate and flood the entire universe. Hare Krishna. Now, if you take one drop, what can you flood with one drop? But he's saying a particle of a drop will flood the entire universe. And even the universe, the material, physical universe, is quite inconceivable. Even the greatest scientists, the more they understand, the more they understand they don't understand. Now, the difference between a material scientist and a spiritual scientist, in one sense, is the more a material scientist understands what he doesn't understand, he becomes very proud. I understand this much of what I don't, of what is inconceivable. But a spiritual scientist is really humbled by that. It's not that I'm arrogant that I understand so much of a little drop of what's infinitely beyond my understanding. We're humbled by that. We don't think I'm great because of what I know. We think Krishna's great because what he knows. And if we take our happiness and my greatness for what I know, then it's very limited. And it's going to cause so much suffering, because there's so many impediments and so many ways it will be lost. And then there's the envy that somebody else knows more, or somebody else could do better. Arrogance that I'm better. Whether it's our singing or our dancing or our puja or our money making or our influence in others or our ability to speak or know or whatever it may be. Whether we're a doctor or a businessman or a lawyer or a politician or a brahmachari or a guru, whatever we may be. If we think that we're the doer, then we have a tendency to think I'm better than someone who could do less. Or we become depressed or envious of someone who could do more. But if we think, if we understand, Krishna's the doer. And Krishna's inconceivable in everything. He could lift Govardhan Hill with the little finger of his left hand, effortlessly, and be smiling the whole time. It takes us so much trouble just to walk around the hill. And it's only a fraction of a size it was when Krishna lifted it. When Krishna lifted it, with what's apparently the weakest part of the body, the tip of the little finger of the left hand. And it wasn't that he just lifted the hill. Indra, the most powerful of the demigods in the Swargaloka region, the king of the devas, he's throwing his most dangerous thunderbolts on the hill. He's sending winds, cyclones, tornadoes, hurricanes, like when these things happen in the world today, you know, they're powerful, but they're just kind of happening due to karmic, you know, blending of different situations. But here Indra is taking the full power of all of these resources and attacking Govardhan Hill. The rains, the wind, the thunderbolts, the lightning. And Krishna's just smiling. And ultimately Indra understood Krishna's inconceivable. So when we humble ourselves in a spirit of bhakti or devotion, then Krishna reveals himself to us. And then, what is the conception we actually gain? It's never that we can understand the limits of Krishna's beauty, his sweetness, his love, or his pastimes, what to speak of his external energy of material creation, the Mahatattva. But what Krishna reveals to us is what awakens our deepest love for him. What awakens the deepest desire to surrender to his love. That is the highest realization. We cannot become God. God doesn't become God. God never forgets he's God. But we can become, in Krishna's eyes, better than God. That's quite inconceivable. Try to understand in logical terms, how could the quantity in one drop contain more water than the limitless ocean? Can you fathom that? But for Krishna, the amount of love within his devotees, within that drop, Krishna says, with all that I have, I can never repay you. I can't match this. That's what he told gopis. That's what Ram told Hanuman. What you have done for me, I cannot repay you. All I can do is just give you myself. And he embraced him. The gopis, you gave up everything for me. What did they give up? It's difficult what they gave up, but considering Krishna, you know, they have a few family affairs and they gave it up for Krishna, which was difficult on their little level. But Krishna saw, because they did it with such devotion, with such love, he said, even in a lifetime of Brahma, 311 trillion years, with everything I have in all material and spiritual worlds, I cannot even begin to repay you. In other words, Krishna's seeing more in the drop than in the ocean. This is bhakti. This is how Krishna appreciates the love of a devotee. And the purpose of understanding Krishna is not to know him. The purpose of understanding Krishna is to love him. Because you can't really know him. But if you love him, Krishna makes himself known to us. And ultimately, when we study the holy scriptures to get a conception of Krishna's beauty and Krishna's lila and the various intricacies of the components of his lila and the different nature of love, and when we try to understand Shirodakshai Vishnu, Garbodakshai Vishnu, Karanadakshai Vishnu. We're supposed to really try to understand all of these. How the three modes of material nature works, how time is working, prakriti, the entire cosmic manifestation, and the energies of the Lord. There's incredible books within the Vaishnava literatures that describe, you know, Samkhya philosophy that Kapila Dev is teaching his mother. And his mother understood everything he was saying. And if you read Samkhya philosophy, some of us, we have to read it many times. One verse we have to read for years before we understand. He just spoke all the verses one time to his mother. She understood everything because of her devotion. He gave her the understanding. And what was the understanding? She was completely humbled by his mercy, by his grace, by his love. And she loved him. That was her understanding. I'm yours. That was Hanuman's understanding. And what kind of scholar was Hanumanji? Incredible. He knew shastras, he knew slokas, he knew philosophies, he knew everything. Masterfully. He was blessed by Vayudev. He studied scriptures from Suryadev. But what was his conclusion? Ram, how can I please you? I'm yours. And because that was his conclusion, Ram said, I cannot repay you. I'm yours. So when we go to study Srila Prabhupada's books, when we study these holy scriptures, this should be our attitude. We're not studying to be scholars. We're studying so that we can receive the divine grace of Krishna and his devotees. And we want to share that divine grace because that's what pleases Krishna most. Katayantashtamam nityam tushyanti charamandicha. Devotees take much pleasure by sharing Krishna with each other. So when Krishna wants to bring out the qualities of his devotees for limitless reasons, actually, anything Krishna does, there are limitless ways to explain it from limitless perspectives. That's why Ananta Shesha can't, when it says that he can't describe what Krishna or Lord Chaitanya does in one moment, cannot explain one moment of their pastimes in the entire span of a creation. What does that mean? That means one moment, it can be, Krishna saying one word, that's a moment. Krishna making one motion is a moment. It can be explained from infinite perspectives, in truth, not speculative or imaginary. That's Krishna. When Lord Brahma tells Ishvara Parama Krishna Sachit Ananda Vigraha Anadira Dira Govinda Sarva Karana Karanam, that Krishna is the cause of all causes, the supreme Ishvara Parama, and his body is eternal, full of knowledge and full of bliss. That full is inconceivable. That full knowledge and that full bliss and that eternal nature, that's Krishna and everything he does. An expansion of Krishna. He just takes a moment of a glance and he impregnates the entire material nature with limitless living entities. A moment glance. What can we do with a moment glance? Hare Krishna. That's Krishna. And that is a very, very expansion of a form for material nature. What to speak of Krishna, Shamsundar, when he glances on you? When Krishna glances on his devotee in Goloka Vrindavan or Gokul Vrindavan, that glance is actually limitlessly more potent than Mahavishnu's glance that impregnates the entire creation with all living beings. But Krishna, infinitely more potent than that, when he glances on his devotee, he's impregnating that devotee with his love. And he may even glance at you longer than a moment. In fact, when Krishna's with gopis, every gopi is thinking he's only looking at me all the time. And when he's with the gopas, the cowherd boys, sitting in Yamuna, they're thinking he's only looking at me. So what is that glance? What is the effect of it? This is Krishna. And just as we love to glorify Krishna, Krishna loves to glorify devotees. So Krishna's pastimes with his great, great devotees, on one level, it is always to increase the dynamic, pure spirit of their love, to activate it in special ways. And also, when Krishna activates the nature of his devotees' love, then all of us, for all time, when we hear about it or read about it, we actually get some better understanding of what's in their hearts. Like the story of little Prahlad. If everything in his life just went so nice, his father put him on his lap and said, "What is the best thing that you learned in school?" And little Prahlad said, "Father, oh best of demons, you are stuck in a deep, dark, blind well due to your ignorance and you can't get out. And nobody can even help you unless you take shelter of Krishna." His father could have just said, "Prahlad, you're only 5 years old. Why should I take the words of a little child like you seriously? Go back to school." Yes. Most fathers would do that for a five-year-old boy. But his father was such an arrogant tyrant, he was insulted. And eventually he tried to kill Prahlad in so many ways. He tried to torture him, he tried to intimidate him, he tried to, in every way, put fear in his heart, put... He gave the example that Prahlad, just like a tree, somebody takes a branch off a tree, and they put an axe at the end, and that branch becomes the handle for the axe. And then a person who takes a branch from a tree makes it the handle for an axe, and then cuts down the same tree with it. So that's what you are. You are my son. You're a branch. You're coming from me. But because you have devotion to Vishnu, who's like the axe, you're like his handle. You've come to cut me down by your devotion. Therefore, I am fully justified to destroy you before you destroy me. Prahlad didn't want to destroy his father. He loved his father. But you see, when Prahlad was in that, it was like a very, very hard stone grinding him. But what happened when he was being ground? Through those trials and tribulations, he didn't become angry, he didn't become envious, he didn't lose his faith, he didn't become depressed. It just brought out the qualities in his heart that we would have never really known what it really was unless he was ground by that rock. Serious rock, too, Hiranyakashipu. And similarly, little Dhruva Maharaj. In so many ways, he would put through tests. And those tests actually brought out his bhakti, like rubbing camphor. And that's the way Krishna brings out our devotion, too, through putting us in testing situations, if we are sincere. And Krishna does this for his devotees so that he can Mahajano Yena Gatasa Panta to teach us how to do. So in these beautiful stories that we're reading from Srimad Bhagavatam, Krishna's showing us what true devotion is through his deepest, purest, most loving associates. And at the same time, for his own divine lila of love, he's increasing the ras, or the taste of sweet, ecstatic praying in the heart of his devotee and in his own heart. So we read in this chapter, Rukmini. She was really tested in so many ways. Yesterday, our Chaitanya Charan Prabhu gave a brilliant analysis of this story from so many perspectives. Rukmini loved Krishna with all her heart, with all her mind, with all her strength, with all her soul. She surrendered her everything to Krishna. She never met him physically. She never saw him with her eyes. She just heard about him because her father was actually a very pious devotee king. So great sages would come, people like Narada Muni, and they would talk about Krishna. And they weren't like giving her personal private Bhagavad Katas and her, she was just a girl, a small girl. She would just hear the great sages talking about him to her father or to someone else. And just by hearing about Krishna's qualities, her love awakened, and she gave her full heart to Krishna. But her father, he loved her daughter, but her elder brother, who was very powerful and very influential, he hated Krishna. And he wanted to get his daughter married to the person who hated Krishna more than anyone,
Shishupal. From Shishupal's birth, he was envious of Krishna. And his whole life, he was obsessed with somehow or other giving Krishna a bad name. And he was really good at it, too. And people like him believed what he said. He would say so many terrible things against Krishna. He would just interpret everything, and there was enough truth in it so that it was believable, but it was completely out of context. Yes? Krishna was a cowherd boy. There's truth in that. But he would make that such an insult to Krishna. So could you imagine? She gave her whole heart to Krishna, and she was to marry a person where she would just hear and see envious blasphemies. He would probably expect her, demand her, force her to cause harm to Krishna. This is traumatic. She sent a message. Krishna got the message the night before the marriage. And the day of the marriage, she went to the beginning of the ceremony by going to Goddess Parvati's temple to get blessings before the marriage. And she's praying to Parvati, please, I don't want to marry this person. I want to marry Krishna. This is serious surrender. She was going, everything was arranged. And yet, for Krishna's seva, she was willing to just upset everything. And she's just a very young girl. And the most powerful kings on the planet were all assembled in support of Shishupal. And right in front of all of them, she just jumped on Krishna's chariot and went away. Hari Hari. That's Rukmini. In the time of such a test, of such a stressful situation, she just, we understand, what is her love? If Rukmi just said, oh, well, I prefer Shishupal, but if you like Krishna, then okay, whatever makes you happy. We wouldn't understand what is the substance of Rukmini's love the way we do. So that stone brought it out. The grinding the camphor brings out the scent. Even I see some, we have these for Chandanyatra, devotees go out and grind the sandalwood against the stone. And this, the sandalwood itself, if you smell it, it's, don't smell it because it's boga, but if you did, not much scent. But when you grind it, then so much of its fragrance come out. So in today's story, Rukmini Devi is in her palace, Krishna's favorite palace. And Krishna's leaning upon her bed, her couch, where she would be sitting. And Rukmini just wants to make Krishna happy. She's the supreme goddess of fortune. And one of her maid servants is fanning Krishna with the chamara. And very graciously, Rukmini takes the chamara from the maidservant because she just wanted to be a maidservant. It's a very humble service. And she was just fanning Krishna. And the description of how beautiful her palace was and how beautiful she was and how beautiful Krishna was. And she's just fanning to please him. And Krishna's seeing how she's just so happy. Such a simple service. Sometimes we think, you know, I'm so qualified. I should be giving something very qualified to do. Yes. Well, here is. Rukmini is on a higher level than Lakshmi, the goddess of fortune. Same person, but higher opulence and higher, deeper bhava is within Rukmini than Lakshmi even. She's the Shakti. We all have some experience of how powerful Maya is. Yes? In our own experience and seeing what she does to others, Maya is the external energy of Rukmini. The whole Mahamaya that's permeating this world is Rukmini's energy. So she's very powerful. And she's the primary queen, the first of them, senior most. But just fanning Krishna with a fan. We have chamaras there. Anyone in the temple, you all have the opportunity. You can just come to the temple with a chamara and fan Krishna and Radharani, Gopal. Yes? Even your little children could do it. You can give little chamara to your 3-year-old child and can fan. But that's the simple, menial, humble service that Rukmini was doing, that literally anyone, anywhere could do it. But she was smiling in ecstasy because she was just so happy to render this simple little service to Krishna. And Krishna was looking at her and feeling her love and feeling her love was just, Krishna, I'm yours. I want to please you. So Krishna wanted to agitate that love, to bring it out in sweeter, more intensified ways. Krishna decided, I want to make her angry. I've never seen her angry. She just never gets angry. She's always, whatever Krishna does, how may I please you? Whatever Krishna doesn't do, how may I please you? If Krishna's harsh with her, if Krishna's sweet with her, whatever, how can I please you? Ashlisyava patiratam panashtumam. Chaitanya Mahaprabhu concludes Shikshastakam that Krishna, if you want, you can embrace me. Or if you like, you can trample on me. Or if you like, you can neglect me and make me brokenhearted. You have a right to do anything you like with me because I'm your servant unconditionally. Rukmini Devi really embodied this principle. But Krishna really wanted to make her angry because he wanted to see that aspect of her ecstatic love. So he started speaking. And the words he spoke have been discussed in the previous classes. But more or less, he was putting down himself in such a way that it appeared that he was going to leave her. You could say, I don't want to be with you, so I'm leaving. Or you could say, I'm so totally unqualified to be with you that we shouldn't be together anymore. It's kind of the same thing, isn't it? So he was telling Rukmini that you are so beautiful and you're so virtuous. I don't deserve to be your husband. I really shouldn't be your husband. You're a princess. And Shishupal was going to be a king. After I killed Kamsa, I could have been a king. But I gave the kingdom over to Ugrasena. So I'll never be the king. You deserve to be the wife of a king. I've already given my kingdom away to somebody else. And you deserve to be married to a great hero. And myself, I'm hiding on an island in the ocean. And in so many ways, he was saying like this, I'm not qualified to be with you. And then he told her, actually, you should go out and find a husband that is qualified for you. And he was just joking, but he was saying it in such a way that Rukmini couldn't understand it was a joke. She took him very seriously. And as he was speaking, she just put her head down and tears were pouring from her eyes in complete distress. In feeling of separation, imminent separation from Krishna. And her limbs were just burning with distress. They trembled. Her heart was palpitating as tears were pouring from her eyes and mixing with her black ointment kajal, and it was falling over her body and on the floor. And suddenly it became so overwhelming that her body and mind just couldn't survive in such a traumatic state of total humility, that I'm going to lose Krishna. She fainted. She just collapsed. The Srimad Bhagavatam said she collapsed like a tender little banana tree that's knocked down by a strong wind. And that wasn't the reaction Krishna was expecting. He was expecting her to chastise him. Why are you saying these things? That's what most wives would say. What are you talking these things? This is not true. But Rukmini didn't say a word. She just cried and cried and cried until she collapsed. And Krishna was so moved by that that he immediately jumped off the bed and wanted to please Rukmini so much. He manifested forearms so he could do so many things. He lifted her up, he caressed her, he cleaned the kajal of her tears from her body, and he was doing all these things with his arms to make her happy, and he was speaking very sweet words. He was saying, Rukmini, I was just joking with you. And when Rukmini understood that in her total simplicity, then she replied to his words, after she had the security of knowing that Krishna's mine and I am Krishna's. And here she's about to explain every single argument that Krishna said why he's unqualified, to prove how his words are actually proving that he is supremely qualified in every way. So Krishna's arguing that I'm not qualified for you, Rukmini. And in the verses that are to come in the in the future classes we'll be reading, Rukmini is showing what you're actually saying is, I'm not qualified for you. So this is the spiritual world. In the material world, everyone wants to prove themselves better than other people. But in the spiritual world, Krishna is saying, I'm not qualified for you, and Rukmini is saying, I'm not qualified for you. And they're using the same logic and the same words to express their own realizations. In other words, each one is conquering the other by their love. In Chaitanya Charitamrita, the mood of Sri Rukmini was perfectly manifested in Gadadhar Pandit. And there are many such stories which describes the quality of Gadadhar. He is Srimati Radharani, the full-fledged manifestation of Sri Radha, the Hladini Shakti, has incarnated in this world as Gadadhar Pandit. But he's Sri Radha in the mood of Sri Rukmini Devi. And Krishnadas Kaviraj Goswami tells Jagadananda Pandit was also an expansion of Sri Radharani in the mood of Satyabhama. And their love was very one and different. Satyabhama, we have read the story. Krishna gave Rukmini a single parijata flower. And Satyabhama said, I want a parijata tree. Krishna went through a lot of effort to go to Indraloka, and there was a war and everything like that, and he gave a parijata tree to Satyabhama. Now, but Rukmini was content with her flower. She could have said, well, you know, I want a tree also, because trees have limitless flowers. She was happy with one flower. So Satyabhama was very much away for Krishna's pleasure only. She would sometimes argue with Krishna. Rukmini always just accepted whatever Krishna wanted. So Jagadananda, he would see Lord Chaitanya. And he would, so many times, he would say, Lord Chaitanya, you shouldn't be doing like this. He brought that pot of very, very fragrant sandalwood oil. And he gave to Govinda and said, please massage Lord Chaitanya with this oil. It will make him very happy and it will make him very nice. So Govinda understood Lord Chaitanya, and he also understood Jagadananda Pandit. And they were both senior to him in many ways. So Govinda, okay, I got Jagadananda Pandit ordered me to, I don't know if Lord Chaitanya is going to want this, but he's ordered me. So he brought the sandalwood oil, and he was about to massage, and Lord Chaitanya said, what is that? And Govinda said, it's sandalwood oil. Who gave you the sandalwood oil? He said, Jagadananda Pandit. When Lord Chaitanya heard that, he got afraid. But still, he said, I am a sannyasi. I cannot be massaged with such highly expensive, fragrant oils. Give the sandalwood oil to Jagannath, and they will massage Lord Jagannath with the oil. So Jagannanda came and asked Govinda, did Lord Chaitanya enjoy the oil? And Lord Chaitanya said that the oil should be given to Jagannath. And Jagannanda picked up the pot of oil. And he said, I didn't give you this oil. He threw it on the ground, the clay pot broke, the oil went into the ground. And then he went to his house to fast. You don't accept, I'm fasting. So Lord Chaitanya, after a couple days of him fasting, he said, please, Lord Chaitanya came to his house and said, please make prasad for me. Another time he gave Lord Chaitanya a nice bed to sleep on. It was a simple bed, but it was nice because Lord Chaitanya was sleeping on the hard floor. And Lord Chaitanya, Govinda, put the bed down, and Lord Chaitanya said, sannyasis don't sleep on such nice beds. Who gave you this bed? Govinda said, Jagadananda. Lord Chaitanya said, he rejected it. So Jagadananda was very disturbed. And he would speak what he would speak, he would act in such ways. Sometimes a little boy would come, the son of a widow, and Lord Chaitanya would give him so much affection. Jagadananda said, what will people say? And Lord Chaitanya said, Jagadananda, I think you should go to Vrindavan for some time and stay with Sanatana Goswami. So this was their relationship. And even in Vrindavan, Jagannanda, it was an expression of his ecstasies of love. He actually really made Lord Chaitanya happy. When he was with Sanatana Goswami, he saw Sanatana Goswami had this saffron cloth around his head. And he was so happy. You are honoring Lord Chaitanya so nicely by putting his cloth over your head. I'm so happy to see that. And Sanatana Goswami said, actually, it's the cloth of someone else. And he said, Jagannanda picked up a pot and attacked him. And Sanatana Goswami was really happy. He said, I just wanted to test your love for Lord Chaitanya, and you've showed it, and it's incredible. I'm very happy. Put down the pot, Or beat me, whatever you like. And when Sanatana Goswami, who is the Sambandha Guru of our Sampradaya, he's the Guru of Rupa Goswami, Sanatana Goswami, who was our Abhideya Guru. He wrote Bhakti Rasamrita Sindhu, Ujjvala Nilamani. Sanatana Goswami is his Guru. When Sanatana Goswami was in Puri and he had those infections on his body due to drinking water, and there was blood and pus coming out and so painful, and it covered his entire body. And Lord Chaitanya kept embracing him, and the blood would get on Lord Chaitanya's beautiful golden form. So Sanatana Goswami confided in Jagadananda, I came here because I wanted to make spiritual advancement, but I'm just making offenses. Jagannanda said, well, actually, Lord Chaitanya told you he wanted you to go to Vrindavan, so why don't you just go to Vrindavan? Sanatana Goswami said, yes, that's what I will do. And the next day, Lord Chaitanya came to embrace him, and he tried to run away. Lord Chaitanya embraced him, and Jagannanda said, actually, I'm going to Vrindavan. Sanatana Goswami said, I'm going to Vrindavan. He said, why are you going to Vrindavan? He said, well, I explained my situation to Jagannanda, and he told me to go to Vrindavan. And Lord Chaitanya said, who is this Jagga? He's an impudent neophyte. who is he to instruct you who are fit to even be my guru? He was angry. And when Sanatan Goswami, because he knows what Ras is, he knows what ecstatic love is. He said, Jagadananda is so fortunate, and I'm so unfortunate. He's tasting the sweetness of your harsh, bitter words. And I'm, because I'm such an outsider, he's so intimate. You speak like that about him, but I'm such an outsider, so unqualified, that you only say nice things about me. So in this way, it was revealed, the elevated position of Jagadananda Pandit. But this is how he was giving ecstasy to Lord Chaitanya, and how Lord Chaitanya was giving ecstasy to him. And Gadadhar Pandit was like Rukmini. Just wanted to please and to serve with such a simple heart. When Lord Chaitanya said, I'm going to Vrindavan, Gadadhar Pandit said, I'm going with you because everyone else is going, so I'm also going. Lord Chaitanya said, everyone else could go, but you cannot go. Can you imagine? Put yourself in that heart. Lord Chaitanya is going to Vrindavan, his first attempt. All the devotees were going with him. To go with Lord Chaitanya to Vrindavan, have kirtan all the way, have King Prataparuja was arranging prasad feasts, you know, throughout Orissa. It's really the most incredible pilgrimage. And everyone else was free to come. But Gadadhar, you took Chaitra Sannyas, so you cannot come. And ultimately, he didn't go. It's a long story. But Lord Chaitanya didn't go to Vrindavan. And when he came back, he said, Krishna wouldn't let me go because I caused pain to the heart of Gadadhar Pandit. And he said, only if you bless me, Gadadhar, will Krishna allow me to go to Vrindavan. And Gadadhar said, you are independent, you are free, I just want you to do anything you want, just come to my house for prasad. And on another occasion, when Balabhabhata came from the Prayag area to visit Lord Chaitanya in Puri, beautiful story, but it's very late. But the conclusion of the story is Lord Chaitanya Mahaprabhu wanted to actually perform this very, very intimate leela. In the very beginning of the chapter of Sri Chaitanya Charitamrita, where it describes this, where it appears Lord Chaitanya is chastising Balabhabhata, Bhaktivinoda Thakur explains he was joking with Balabhabhata. But he wouldn't listen to his description of Srimad Bhagavatam if he wasn't following in the footsteps of the great Sridhar Swami. Because Lord Chaitanya wanted to teach the world through this intimate pastime that unless one is humbly following in the footsteps of the previous acharyas, then the full current of Krishna's grace is not going to come. However scholarly we are, however qualified we are, we have to humble ourselves to follow in the footsteps of the previous acharyas. Mahajano yena gata sapanta. So because Lord Chaitanya wouldn't listen, none of the devotees would listen. It's interesting. In Gorgano Deshtapika, which is the authorized explanation of the identity, the inner identity of all Lord Chaitanya's associates, recognized by all the acharyas, written by the son of Shivananda Sen, Kavi Karnapur. He identifies that Balabhabhata is Sukadev Goswami. Who knows Srimad Bhagavatam better than Sukadev Goswami? He spoke Srimad Bhagavatam. But Lord Chaitanya, this is a lila, an intimate lila. So because Lord Chaitanya would not listen, others would not listen either. But Balabhabhata would come to Gadadhar Pandit because he knew Gadadhar Pandit was very gentle and didn't like to displease people. And he was very humble and very, he was like Rukmini. And he said, I want you to hear Srimad Bhagavatam. And Gadadhar Pandit couldn't say no to him. So he just started reading it, and every day he would come and read and read and discuss and read. And Gadadhar Pandit was thinking, Lord Chaitanya is going to be angry with me, but he's in my heart, so he'll understand. But the devotees, they won't understand. They will criticize me. But still he listened from day after day after day. And eventually, Balabhabhata, he understood that Sri Chaitanya Mahaprabhu, out of his compassion, out of his mercy, out of his love, just like Krishna removed the pride of Indra, he's doing this for my welfare. And then Balabhabhata came and he completely accepted Lord Chaitanya's mercy. And Lord Chaitanya embraced him. And then Balabhabhattacharya said, please come to my house for prasad. And Lord Chaitanya said, I will come. And there was a nice philosophical discussion there too. So Lord Chaitanya told Swarup Damodar Goswami, Jagadananda, Pandit and Govinda, please go and get Gadadhar Pandit and bring him to the house. So they went to get him, and on the way, Swarup Damodar Goswami asked Gadadhar Pandit, Lord Chaitanya spoke very harshly about you. He really tested you. He neglected you. He criticized you. And you didn't do anything wrong. Why didn't you retaliate? Why didn't you say something? And Gadadhar Pandit replied that Sri Chaitanya Mahaprabhu is the all-knowing, fully independent, supreme personality of Godhead. He could do anything he likes. He is perfectly, supremely omniscient. He knows everyone's heart. And I know that he knows all my strengths and all my faults. And I know he will give his mercy upon me. Who am I to question him? What example will that show to others if I'm questioning the all-omniscient Supreme Lord of all creation? He will bestow his mercy despite my faults. And Swarup Damodar Goswami was really moved, such a spirit of surrender. And then he came before Lord Chaitanya. And it was many days. He wasn't really coming because Lord Chaitanya was neglecting him. And he fell at Lord Chaitanya's feet and wept tears of gratitude. And Lord Chaitanya embraced him. He said, Gadadhar, I tried to test you. I spoke harsh words about you. And I neglected you because I wanted to see you get angry. But you didn't get angry. You just tolerated everything. He said, you were so steadfast in your simplicity that you have purchased me. I am yours. This is the quality of Gadadhar, his simplicity. And Lord Chaitanya is giving this direction to the whole world for all time to come. This sarala bhava is the words Lord Chaitanya uses. He is purchased by the simplicity of the love of his devotee. No duplicity. Not complicated. Even the greatest of our philosophers, they had such simple, loving hearts. Srila Bhakti Siddhanta Saraswati told, the first qualification for a true devotee is sarala, simplicity. Unless we build our cultivation of knowledge, our tapasya, our austerities, our sadhana, everything we do, unless we build it on a foundation of simplicity, it's not really going to deeply connect us to Krishna. First qualification. And Lord Chaitanya, he said, because of the simplicity of your love, you have purchased me. And then Krishnadas Kaviraj Goswami, because Lord Chaitanya was so purchased by the simplicity of the love of Gadadhar, Lord Chaitanya's name is Gadadhar Prananath. He's the Lord of the life force of Gadadhar. And Lord Chaitanya loves to be associated with his devotees. That's the greatest glorification that Krishna loves to hear, is how he is connected with his devotees. Nanda Nandana, Yashoda Nandana, Gopinath, Radhapati, Rukmini Raman, Prahlad Priya, the Lord loves to be glorified through the glorification of his devotees. So this simplicity of Rukmini is, it conquered Krishna. And Krishna tested her, wanting her to get angry. But what really happened here? She defeated him. He couldn't make her get angry. And Gadadhar Pandit too. Lord Chaitanya really, really put the pressure on. But he couldn't make Gadadhar angry at him. He tried. Because his heart was just so simple to please the Lord. Whatever you want to say, whatever you want to do, I'm yours. So it's better for us to follow in the footsteps of Gadadhar Pandit than Jagadananda Pandit. And Rukmini rather than Satyabhama. They are both on the highest platforms of prema, ecstatic love. But the lesson is very much how the Lord brings out the love for his own enjoyment and for his devotees' enjoyment through the love of his devotees. In Vrindavan, Krishna makes Radharani angry. But the only reason why he makes Radharani angry is to increase her love for him. And the only reason Radharani becomes angry is to increase Krishna's love. Srila Prabhupada has given us this incredible world of spiritual love. And when we share this love with each other, we live in the spiritual world. Thank you very much. Any questions? I know I'm late, but I'm leaving today for Kanpur, so I will take advantage of using this excuse. Anybody except? Does anyone else have any questions? Yes, Dwarkadish Prabhu. We have been discussing the story of Dwarkadish.
Hare Krishna. I wanted to know how does this phenomenon of inspiration work in our lives? The question is that through our Krishna conscious days of exposure to various festivals, temple programs, lectures, festivals and yatras, we go through a lot of inspirational experiences, and we even express ourselves that Prabhu, this is so nice, I'm inspired, I'm just so inspired, it's the festival is so beautiful, I'm inspired. Nonetheless, in our day-to-day lives, exposed to three modes of material nature, we react many times in our conditioned manners, rightly or wrongly. So how does really inspiration work? Does it really sort of cumulatively come up in a way where we ultimately will react or think or behave in the right way at some point of time, in spite of the three modes around us? Or because, you know, this inspiration which we gather, is it a sustained thing in our heart? Do we keep on gathering that inspiration? Because there's so much inspiration available in our movement through devotees' activities, every class we hear and every deity aarti we perform and whatever. So how does it really work, this inspiration? It seems to sometimes sort of wane off, and we again are back to what we seem to be like, our conditioned nature seems to manifest. Where did all the inspiration which we gathered for so many years go away?
Hare Krishna. Everything's all right. Inspiration on the spiritual platform is never lost. It's eternal. That is why it is so valuable when we get some spiritual inspiration in a class, in a kirtan, in our japa, on a yatra, in a holy place, with holy people, with friends, in giving Krishna to others. When we feel inspiration, we should really feel grateful, because that inspiration is eternally an asset in our spiritual lives. It's actually never lost. It's a nourishment. When you just eat regular food, it gives you some inspiration in the form of strength and nourishment, but then it's gone. The strength after some days or whatever, it's gone. I'm not going to go into details of how it goes, but our eco village, we have a really nice way of explaining those things. But spiritual inspiration is nourishment that is eternally, forever, an asset in our spiritual lives. So when we get inspiration, we should really know this is something that is eternally going to be with me. But in a conditions, in a semi-conditioned state within this world, there are so many distractions. The inspiration is not lost, any inspiration. Every time you've been inspired in your Krishna consciousness, every moment of that is within you. It It's an investment that can neha bikramanasosti prativayo nivityate. Swapam apyasya dharmasya trayate mahatobaya. Never can be lost. Death cannot take it away. It remains with your soul. So how grateful we should be for any inspiring moment. But it's forgotten. It's easily covered by the conditioned nature of the mind, which is very much affected by external situations. And again, we become distracted. And therefore, the path of bhakti is to regularly cultivate this inspiration. Sadhu sangha, sadhu sangha, sarva sastra koi lava matra sadhu sangha sarva siddhi hoy. A moment's association with a sadhu can open the doors to the highest liberation. Life's perfection. And that's true. A moment can do it. But because our distracted minds, we need to regularly be in the association of devotees. We read in Srimad Bhagavatam, this story itself, that I spoke about Sri Chaitanya Mahaprabhu and Gadadhar Pandit. It says anybody who hears this story will get ecstatic love for Sri Chaitanya Mahaprabhu. Now that's not an exaggeration, that's true. If you really hear it once, it has the capacity just once. But because of our conditioned, distracted mind, we need to hear it. Nasta prayesha badreshu nityam bhagavati sevaya. We need to hear Srimad Bhagavatam Chaitanya Charitamrita on a regular basis. Yes? One name of Krishna chanting purely an ecstatic love awakens in our heart. And it's actually awakening it. Every mantra you chant is an investment, an invaluable investment in your spiritual account. But because of the so many distractions, we have to chant every day to try to keep our mind focused and gradually clean our hearts so that we can realize the great gifts that we have. It's about waking up. When you wake up into pure devotion, then you realize every service you've ever done, every class you've ever heard, every mantra you've ever chanted is a priceless glory. And it's all brought me to the point where I could understand that. But now we're thinking, God, I haven't made any advancement. I've chanted so much, I've been inspired, but now I'm not inspired. So in order to continue till we reach that stage when we could realize what we've been given, we have to regularly balance our lives through hearing and chanting and association with sadhus and going on pilgrimages. It is the perfection, and it's the path of perfection. So it's natural. In the path of Vaidhi Bhakti, there's rules and regulations, there's disciplines, because we don't yet have that really higher taste. We're still trying to clean our hearts. Adosha tatata sadhu sangota bhajanakriya. You know, we associate with sadhus, we perform our sadhana, anartha nivriti, we're removing these anarthas. And unless we're regularly being inspired, we're not able to actually continue the path with enthusiasm. So this inspiration we need to regularly receive. And in giving we receive. By inspiring others, Krishna will inspire us also. So everything's all right. Just keep looking for that inspiration and keep giving that inspiration. And when you forget the inspiration, in many ways, it's like the rock. You're longing for it. Huh? We should be longing for that. Just like Narada Muni, he was so inspired when he saw Vishnu in his heart, when he was a little boy in his previous life. But when Krishna disappeared, Krishna said, I just gave you a little sample, but now I want you to long to have that experience again. And that will purify you for your next life, where you will be my eternal associate, Narada Muni. So treasure, be grateful for the inspiration, know that it's forever a gift that can never be lost. But in order to really realize its value, we need to regularly receive and give this inspiration through our sadhana, through our seva, through our association, through the life that we live. And then we can realize what we've received. Does that answer your question? Is there another question? Yes, Prabhu. He looks inspired.
Hare Krishna Maharaj, outstanding class you gave. Maharaj, regarding this simplicity, you know, Rukmini as well as Gadadhar Pandit, such a elaborately you described. But for us, you know, in the day-to-day affairs which we encounter, it becomes extremely difficult. You know, when we hear this, it becomes very easy, Maharaj. But when practically it comes, I miserably fail about this simplicity. So please enlighten me on this. Thank you.
If you are sincere, your failures are not miserable. They're stepping stones. What is important is our sincerity. That we're honestly, earnestly striving for the right thing. We're striving to give up our egos and be the servant of the Lord. Even though the ego keeps coming back and keeps distracting us. I want to enjoy. I want to be the doer. I want to be glorified. I want my senses to be really happy through experiences. I want my mind to be satisfied through material experiences. We're conditioned since time immemorial to these habits. So our material conditioning should not depress us, should not make us miserable. It should humble us. Humble us to understand how much I really, really need sincerely to take shelter of the gifts that Prabhupada and Krishna have given me. To chant my japa, to perform the kirtan, to associate with devotees, to perform my seva, to perform puja. All of these different wonderful gifts of devotional service are there to gradually liberate us
from the miseries caused by making our goals in life to satisfy our ego, mind, and senses. So really sincerely try to live with spiritual integrity. Really sincerely try to perform your spiritual sadhana, your spiritual practices with your heart. Really try to be respectful to others. Put your egoistic nature, all of our egoistic natures, aside for the higher principle, for the higher purpose. And that's the path of perfection. Madhavananda Prabhu, Dwarkadish Prabhu, Giriraj Prabhu, Vaishnav Seva Prabhu, Vishwarup Prabhu, they're all Bhaktivedanta hospital people. And when patients come to them, Nirmal Chandra Prabhu, so many, Adikeshav Prabhu, when patients come to them, they're given a medicine, they're given a lifestyle change, they're given perhaps a diet, but it's not that immediately they get better. They have to understand the value of what they're given. If you don't understand the value of what your doctor gives you, you're not going to take it. There's much better tasting things to eat. And there's much more fun things to do. So in the same way, Ainichi Asadi Maya Nashi Borolagi, Harina Mahamantra Lao Tumi Magi. Holy name is medicine. But we have serious chronic diseases. Desire to lord it over material nature. It's a very deep chronic disease. But this medicine is 100% effective if we just take it regularly with the right attitude, with patience and determination. Rupa Goswami says, enthusiasm, determination, and patience are the ingredients. And having that enthusiasm and patience is really the formula of sincerity. So really try to have the association and the sadhana by which you have the strength to not fail. And when you do fail, it should give you a strong indication how much more sincere you have to be to make the right choices and to have the spiritual strength to make those choices. So failing could depress us, which has no value whatsoever to our spiritual growth, or it could humble us and make us understand the urgency of how I really do have to take shelter in a deeper way. That's sincerity. So it's very auspicious what you're saying. Does that answer your question? Hare Krishna. And we will end with Ananda Vrindavan.
Hare Krishna Maharaj.
Please make it a very short question.
Maharaj, this pastime, I was just thinking, this pastime of Krishna teasing Rukmini was at the very old age, means their marriage life had a very long span. When Rukmini had children, grandchildren, after that Krishna had this pastime with Rukmini. So I was thinking very seriously into this matter that for us, we people in a household life, it might be like a vanprastha life at that time, we might be doing this, means we might be joking in that age will be coming.
So I feel it that in our household life we need to have this type of a joking type of a thing, but the focus and the goal during that time has to be thoroughly Krishna, because our death is going to come nearby. We can't sacrifice that. And naturally the society, the family members expect us to have little bit jolly or a joking relationship, but under no circumstances our focus, our goal should be sacrificed. And we are not like Krishna who can divert it and turn it and everything can go all right. We cannot do it, and that fear is always going to be there in our life, that by doing that thing our goal and our target or our focus should not be sacrificed. If at all we try to do something nice with our family members for them, to make them happy, we might miss our Krishna consciousness. So how to see to it that we do nice with our family, at the same time our focus doesn't get sacrificed also.
Just make your wife happy, everything. Don't imitate Krishna with your... Just try to please your family nicely by your good example. And that will be the path of your perfection. Does that answer your question? Govinda Prabhu, would you like to add anything? Please give microphone to Govinda Prabhu.
Maharaj, approve your answer.
What? Can
I approve your answer, Maharaj?
It is a authorized, certified answer. Just be a good example. Srila Prabhupada Ki Jai. Thank you very much.